好，各位可能有注意到，今天又不是，也不是小笔电，大笔电，主要是因为这台教室电脑不知道为什么 Teams 开不了。好，所以呢，你们今天选择来上莎士比亚，加油！以前我教英国作家的时候，我会说那是我教过，那是我平常教的课里面最难的一本。但莎士比亚应该会稍微再难一点点，主要是因为莎士比亚的语言资源非常的多元跟丰富。这学期挑的文本我已经尽量选，就是我觉得你们挑战性稍微低一点的，例如说最知名的《罗密欧与朱丽叶》就没有挑，因为虽然故事感觉大家都懂，但是他用的语言，你想嘛，他是讲的爱情故事，他爱情怎么表现？比喻。意象，然后各式文化内涵的丰富的东西，也许读起来比较困难。那另一方面，《罗密欧与朱丽叶》跟英国作家我选的那出戏有点像，所以我就当做你的读过。好，所以我们先来看Moodle 上面的资讯。上过我课的同学应该都算熟悉。好，所以一开始是我的 email 在这边。如果要联络我呢，请不要点我 Moodle 的那个 profile，然后那个 email 是错的，请用这个 email。对。再来，如果你需要加入 Teams，等不及学校帮你加的话。你可以用这个编码把自己加进去。下一个是课纲，我们的 schedule 给你们看一下。OK，好，所以第一周介绍课程，介绍莎士比亚这个人，然后要介绍第一个剧本，我们这学期会上四本，每一本上3周，其中有3本有电影，就是除了第一本以外，其他3本都有电影。但是我们课堂时间有限，所以只能看2部。第3部电影呢，会用补课的方式来看，因为这个10月9号双十节连假呢，学校要我们补假。所以呢，之后我们再选一天，然后那天就会看第4本的电影。如果我们选择补课时间没空的话也没关系，到时候我还是会上传到 Moodle，你可以自己找时间看。对，所以我们2到4周上第一个剧本《瘟疫是商人》的《Merchant of Venice》。第六周看第二个剧本的电影《What to Do About Nothing》，这是无事生非然后花3周来上。这学期我们没有统一期中考、期末考，都是由各任课老师自行安排。那反正对我们没有影响吧，因为我的课程考试本来就是回家给你们一个礼拜时间在线上考试。那我们期中考就是从第9周到第10周是期中考，那因为没有期中考周、期末考周，所以第10周、第9周都要上课，所以第9周是第二个剧本的第3周，然后第10周呢，我们来看第三个剧本的电影，然后我们再花3周上这个剧本《马克白》Macbeth 11、12、13。然后14、15、16，我们就上第4个剧本《暴风雨》The Tempest。如果有同学修过蔡元杰老师的戏剧课的话，他上学期好像上学期还是去年的时候就上这一出。所以我们选来补课的日期会在第14周之前，这样子你们就能够在阅读剧本之前先看部电影。然后第17周，人人 元旦放假，第十八周期末考周，我们期末考其实是从第十六周就开始了啦，啊，所以因为如果从第十八周开始的话，你们时间不够，因为我19周星期四又要送成绩，所以我们第十八周我们就来上一些有趣一点不会考的东西，就是那个14行诗双人，上英国文学课的时候有上过，好像2首还3首，这门课就可以就是挑一些比较不常见的几首，上个5首，当做消遣。好，那没有上过我课的同学，我跟你们讲一下哦。我的课程很重视你自己回去要阅读作品。我们来这边，我每一周会让你们分组讨论一些我准备好的讨论题目，然后到时候。会收集你们的想法，然后再回到大班分享想法，然后再看下周进度的开头。那每一本都是3周嘛？每一本长度不会超过50页，因为这是学校硬奖励的限制，不能超过50页。所以每一周顶多读17页，顶多有最少可能有8页到9页而已。等一下发讲义给你们看就知道了。没有那么大挑战，还可以啊。那这个东西我大概3个小时看完。好，然后学习建议其实很简单。如果你想要多学一点的话，你就多读一点，上课多认真参与。如果你是因为其他原因来修这门课的话，你只要遵守课堂规定、考试规定，记得来上课，你应该分数上就没问题。好，然后配分一如往常，期中40，期末40，出席率20。出席率20这个东西，之前有同学有点疑问，所以我就讲一下。学校规定你缺7周就死杠嘛，系统就把你当掉了。所以，出席率比较合理的算法，应该就是拿前6周来算吧，因为到第7周你还不来，就算不上没差。所以6周。20分除以6周，你缺1周，旷课1周就扣总成绩3分。当然，如果你生病啊或有事的话，那就还好。但是旷课的话，就缺1周扣总成绩3分。对，好，这是课程进度。接下来这边如果。我会尽量就是要宣布的事情都在课堂上宣布了，但是如果就是中间有突然什么事情跟你们讲的话，我会公告在这边，然后系统也会发一封全班信给你们的学号信箱。我知道不是每个同学都常常关心学号信箱，所以每当有新的公告，我会在这里把标题写上来，标题跟日期，这样你一看就知道有没有新的事情要通知，然后就可以点进去了。接下来这个是我打出席率前十的地方，你看不到，我把它隐藏起来。我们用中文上课，所以你不用知道怎么开 YouTube 页面。然后这个，我每一门文学课都会提供这篇文章。如果你不太了解为什么用英语学习要上文学课的话，可以读读看这篇文章，有一些说法。基本说法包含什么？培养同情心啊，同理心啊，也有什么？还有什么可以帮你增广见闻啦，或者是例如说你还没有进到中年老年，你就可以先在心理上有一些准备啦，不会就是被人吓到啦。那有另外一个可能比较不常讨论，就是有研究显示读文学的语文，它的单字量和文法都比较好。主要是因为如果你一直看一些知识性的文章，那你遇到的单字都是知识性的。然后通常深度也不是很深，因为通常都是那种像科普啊、介绍性。可是读文学的话，每个作品都有他自己的故事世界，都有他自己关切的主题，都有不同人物的个性，这些都会反映在语言上面。所以多读文学也可以帮你们，如果认真读的话，可以帮你们就是增强英文能力。Anyway，如果还有疑问或有兴趣的话，可以点进去看。好，接下来 每一出剧本前面都有大概3到5页的简介，那当然我会在课堂上就直接就是讲解给你们听。但是如果你想要了解更深入的话，我都收集在这个档案里面。我没有印在讲义上面，一是因为讲义已经够多了，我不想要再搬更重的东西。然后二是因为学校有我自己的限制，所以简介的部分在这边。那我用的课本它是沙翁全集，所以想必也有就是总序，什么什么莎士比亚是谁啊？他的世代怎么样啊？什么什么？我今天等一下会讲。那我没有提供给你们，是因为它多达100多页，我不想要扫描。但是如果你有兴趣的话，你可以私底下跟我联系，我再把档案就是寄给你。好，下一个，我们这门课会看3部电影。如果你那天没来，或是补课没办法来的话，电影之后就会放到这个云端资料夹里面，可以自己找时间看。那因为也许有同学就是比较不习惯用档案来看电影，都是看什么网飞啊什么，所以要加字幕的话，如果你不会的话，我这边有拍一个短短的 YouTube 影片，资料夹里面都有提供档案的字幕了，你只要学会操作就好。好，然后接下来就是课堂内容，第一个剧本 Virtual Presentations 为你这三人，剧本在这里 PDF 档，然后接下来3周的 PowerPoint 全部都已经准备好了，所以如果你有心想预习的话，通通在 Moodle 上面，或者是你在复习的时候，不大记得上课讲了什么，可以来看这边的课堂档案。可以拿我准备好的讨论题目当做阅读指南，因为我都是会挑一些我自己觉得比较有趣的地方变成问题，所以如果你这些地方比较熟的话，也等于是快速抓到每一个剧本的精髓。那刚刚可能也注意到，我现在正在录影，那到时候每一周的录影档案我会上传 YouTube，然后连接贴在 Moodle 的相应的位置，所以如果刚好错过迟到睡着的话，之后可以回来补课。好，考试规定，我考前会再帮你们。让你阅览，但是要讲的是，如果你上学期没有修我的文学课，考试规定有一点点变化，主要就是防范，就是有些同学就直接用 ChatGPT，然后复制贴上，所以比较重要的变化是你的文章形式，你的答案形式必须是多段落没有上编码的文章。然后呢，你的答案必须要从文本里至少4个不同地方举证，不是4次举证，是4个不同地方。而且就是，虽然我们看电影，但是请不要从电影举证，电影证据不算数。然后再来，之前已经有规定说，如果你引用资料，或者是你从文本举证，你要提供引用出处。但是现在新增加的规定是，如果你答案格式不符，或是没有举对，如果答案格式不符，或是你的举证没有引用出处的话，你的分数只会拿20分，也就是50%。那评分标准，我出的题目都是开放式题目了，没有标准答案。我会让你们就是题干里面会说你觉得是这样还是那样子，你两个都可以选。我是看你如何举证说明，要从4个不同地方举证。所以如果你4个举证都合理，然后都有支持你的答案，你就会拿满分。如果你只举3个的话，会扣4分，举2个扣8分，举1个扣12分。然后没有举证，但是你很认真写的话，就会拿24分，24分就是60%。好，你们仔细想一下哦，刚刚说的配分考试40、40，然后出勤是20。如果你2次考试都符合答案格式，没有抄袭，没有作弊，但是 没有成功的举证出来，就是没有尝试举证，但是最后说明或是感觉就是文不对题或什么，就是你有努力，我看得出来你有努力，你不是随便写，但刚好四次举证都不合理或是无效的话，我会给你24分。所以你看，期中考24，期末考24，48，出席率。只要记得就是来多于不要来，应该都会过的。对，如果你就是努力作答，然后中间出了一些小问题的话，你也不要太紧张。20，20，然后假如你没有旷课的话，也是20，加起来就是60。对，这都设计好了，不用太紧张。好，所以考试前我会再带你们看一遍这些考试规定。如果想了解抄袭的历史渊源，为什么抄袭这么严重的话，这边有一篇文章可以给你们看。如果没有写过申论题答案的话，这边有其他申论题的答案，我当然不会给你这门课申论题的答案。然后考试区块在这边嘛，都是线上带回家一个礼拜时间考试，刚好期末考试是在九月。一个小小试探。好，然后最后下面这边这个是最近研发出来的东西，加分作业。如果你觉得你掐指一算觉得分数好像有点不太够的话，你们可以来写加分作业。如果成功的话，就会拿最低60分，就是总成绩就会我就会直接打60。可是所谓成功，并不是说。哦，老师不想当你，他只是给我们一个交出来的东西，他就让我们过，并不是这个意涵在于，我分数都已经设计成这样了，你只要有一点努力都会过，你还不过的话，你这个最好给我努力一点。所以关键在这里，meaningful words，什么叫 meaningful？从你个人的经验来讲，然后真的要去反思这个题目要你去反思的东西。那这个上学期已经有一，就是我已经让学生有机会可以去写，所以如果你这个东东写过了，然后有成功拿到就是加分的分数的话，请跟我讲，因为我就不让你写一样的东西写两遍嘛，我另外还要准备文章，跟我讲，我再给你新的加分题目。好，然后最后尤其是加分题，因为会算次数。所以你只能交 Word 档。那交 Word 档的时候，你要注意如果你是用 Google Docs 去写，然后转档的话，可能会出现这个问题。这个我作文课常遇到。请问一下，这张图哪边有问题？有人看出问题在哪吗？他这边说我画起来了有5个字，应该是5个字元吧，对不对？这个就是 Google Docs，从 Google 档案格式转到 Word 格式，它会变全形，每一个字母都算一个字。所以你以为你写到1000字了，其实你只写200。所以如果你要写加分作业的话，请你注意。可能会有这个问题，最好的解决方式就是你如果用 Google Docs 写的话，你就把它复制，然后再贴到 Word 上面，不要用转档，或是你就直接下载就是行动版的 Word，这样你就可以在手机上面直接在那边就可以写。那当然，行动版的 Word 有些限制嘛，比如说它不会给你算字数啦，它你没办法缩排啊。另外好像也需要付费吧，但是付费的话，学校有账号可以申请，学校有那个 Microsoft 365账号。可以上知网处网站申请。OK，所以 Moodle 长这个样子，有要提问吗？没有的话，我们开始讲，就是莎士比亚是谁，然后就是要注意哪些面向。所以换一个画面。莎士比亚是英国。 文艺复兴的巅峰人物，甚至有人觉得说，就是因为有莎士比亚出现，所以才能把那段时间称为英国文艺复兴。16世纪末，17世纪初，莎士比亚活跃的时间就在那段时间，大概1590-91年开始活跃，一直到1611-12。那就有一点小小尴尬，因为伊丽莎白女王是1601年过世，所以她其实刚好横跨了两个君王，她下一个是詹姆斯一世，苏格兰人。这个等一下我们就是再详细讲。莎士比亚他虽然他不是贵族阶级，但是他的父亲算是有头有脸的地主。所以他家也不算穷，能够把他送去上学。那个时候的学校通常那个基本科目是古希腊文、拉丁文，看就是基本的数学、音乐、艺术史。所以没有英文，那个时候大家都会觉得说英文是日常用语，不值得去学习。因为像以前我们对于就是什么什么闽南语、客家语那种想法。那所以，英文的部分都是张自己从生活中的观察，以及他自己对英文这个语言的理解去做的创新。为什么他被誉为英国文学最厉害的人呢？其中一个原因就是因为有超过500个单字第一次出现都是在莎剧里面出现，他对英文的掌握非常的。了解。最近有研究发现，原本以为他创建的那个单字更多，但是最近发现，其实有些单字是生活中已经在用的，只是没有人写下来，他只是第一个写下来的。但这也证明说，他取材不仅限于传统经典的材料，他愿意从生活中取材，使用一般人民使用的语言，这也算是一个创举。那个时候，最盛行脍炙人口，人们最关心的问题是戏剧，所以你看，这是一个巨变。这个是莎士比亚，中期他跟其他演员合资成一个就是剧团，然后他们带了这个环球剧院。今天伦敦有重建版本，因为后来烧掉了，但是因为它的历史地位越发重要，所以就有人觉得说，为了历史考据，为了就是重现莎剧原版的表演形式，应该重建一座。所以现在伦敦离原址不远的有新建新的环球剧院，剧场应该说环球剧场。所以，他父亲是一个。在有钱的中产阶级人物，他父亲是做皮革匠。一般文献会写说他是做手套，其实不只是手套只是他的专长，他还会做一些其他跟皮革相关的。所以他要能够做皮革制品，他就必须要养牛，要养牛就必须要有地，因此他也是一个地主。莎士比亚大概1580年代末。到伦敦中间有一长段的文献缺陷，我们中间不太了解他发生什么事情。但是后来大概1590年代前后，他就出现在文献里，说是一个演员，而且表现还不错。后来他跟另外一些剧作家合写了剧本，然后渐渐从合写变成就是自己一个人写。然后写剧本呢，他就对剧团很重要嘛，所以他有分量，他就可以加入合资，然后变成剧团的核心人物。那个时候的舞台剧跟现在的什么电视剧、电影剧本很像，他不是非常 care 说某一个人的个人风格怎么样啊，要保护自己的知识产权怎么样。基本上只要有人有 idea 丢出来，大家就一起合写，然后生出一个剧本来。 甚至就像是今天在拍戏的时候，可能当天导演就会稍微修改剧本，或者演员会出一些新的 idea，然后就跟着新的 idea 去拍，不一定完全遵守原本的剧本。当时也是，剧作家把剧本草稿写好之后呢，他会按照不同人物需要的台词分不同的，就是每一个演员拿到一份，只有他自己台词。所以今天演员的角色，英文会说他是他的 part，就是来从这边来的，只有他那个人一部分。所以每个人手上拿到他的 part，他会有什么时候进场，然后进场上一句的台词是什么，就听到这句台词你就要进场，然后讲完之后会有该如何出场，然后每个演员手上就拿这些。那所以演员看过一遍整出戏在干嘛之后，通常就不会再看第二遍了，他知道大概讲什么，然后记得自己台词就好。这是因为当时戏剧是大众的娱乐，所以一个剧团不可能一次只演一出，甚至一个剧团一周之内可能演八不同出剧，所以演员要记的东西非常多。你叫他记整本剧本，他可能脑容量不够。那所以相反的，就是每一出戏演出的次数也不多，很多剧只能演一次两次就没了。最脍炙人口的人，顶多演个15遍。然后就不止出版，然后不会再演，是流动性非常快的一种文学形式。所以演员也会参与，就是如果他觉得说他这个人物写的跟他想的不太一样，可能也会稍微修改，然后会跟剧作家、跟剧团商量什么。所以我们今天看到的剧本，不一定跟莎士比亚本人写的草稿一样，当然我们不知道，因为我们没有他本人的草稿可以确认。但是我们从当时其他剧作家的工作形式可以合理推断，应该是有经过别人的参与，是一个共同创作的概念。好，所以他们的剧团在16世纪的时候是。那个时候的文学其实不被视为一个高尚的艺术，可能写诗的话就是个人兴趣，也许会有人因为他的诗而成名，但是不会去卖啊，不会去想要变得像明星一样，他单纯就是一个贵族之间的嗜好。所以这些剧作家啦、演员啦。如果这个不算是一个正当事业的话，他们要如何维生？当然有收票钱啦，但是那个钱非常少。大部分剧团他们靠的是仰赖一个贵族的支持，那个概念是有点像是我雇你们为我宫廷里的人，然后我来养你们，然后呢，你们创作出来的作品呢？就是可以献给我啦，或者是表演给我看啦，或者也许我会指定题目让你们写，诸如此类的。所以，莎士比亚这个剧团，他们是当时数一数二的剧团，他们那个撑腰的贵族还那个等级蛮高的。但是，1601年伊丽莎白女王过世之后，宫廷大翻变了，詹姆斯一王一世上位。然后他们就一要变成国王的剧团，是国王亲自就是支付他们的薪水，算薪水吧，然后所以他们这个剧团就会去想说国王可能会拍什么样的戏，这个我们在讲那个马克白的时候会多讲一点，因为马克白其实就跟詹姆斯一世就很有关系。然后大概也是在17世纪初那段时间呢，渐渐的研发出新的室内照明技术。以前就会就是都是有火把嘛，那以前就会有通风问题啦，会有就是会不会让剧院烧起来这些问题啊。可是到了17世纪初，开始有办法去解决这些问题，所以渐渐的增多了室内演出的机会。那室外演出像这种， 跟室内演出是像我们现在比较常看到的那种方形舞台，就差很多啊。就像看演员他如何表演，他投射到哪一个方向，以及如果要做声光效果的话，能不能做出来，如何设计，这些差别都蛮大的。所以越到晚期的作品，通常特效越多，然后表演形式也会有点不一样。所以我们在看第四本《暴风雨》的时候，这个也可以留意。那个就是被誉为莎士比亚的奇幻作品之一。大家还能懂？好，所以因为他莎士比亚的作品是有许多创新的地方，然后又能够让一般观众很想看，非常脍炙人口，所以。他自己没有去想说要把他的作品集结出版，因为毕竟就是大家就是共同创作，是非常仰慕他的观众或者是其他剧作家。也许有人在看戏的时候写小抄，然后几个人合写，然后再回去比对，看能不能重建这出戏在讲什么，或者是有人在莎士比亚过世之后拿了一些修改过的剧本版本，然后拿去。送印，所以我们今天流传下来的不同版本的莎剧，都是从这两个来源来，要么就是现场重建，要么就是事后找到一些文件，然后修修改改送印。也就是说，我们没有一本剧本是完全出自莎士比亚手，即便是他们自己剧团之后也有人修改过。所以莎剧，在学术上面有一个很重要的领域，就是编辑，不同版本的剧本如何选出。你要使用哪一个版本，或者是，比如说某一行如果有不同的写法，你要用哪一行，或者是哪有些单字有差异，你要如何选择哪一个单字？所以每一个莎剧版本都会略有不同，编辑通常都会去参考历届的版本以及原稿和自己做一些判断。所以我们讲莎剧的时候，其实哪一个版本也很重要。如果你要回去找中文版的话，有时候会跟。我们课堂上用的英文版会有一点不一样，这个要注意的。好，那所以当时的剧本长什么样子呢？因为要让演员容易记得他们的台词，所以他们大部分是用韵文写。韵文就是英文最典型的韵文格式，就是不押韵，五步抑扬格。Unrhymed iambic pentameter，我再讲一会儿没有用。意思是说，英文的诗都是轻音跟重音交叠的编排，形成格律。抑扬格意思是说，先轻再重，先抑再扬，先轻再重。五步的意思就是说，每一行由五组这样轻重搭配。所以，譬如说。我随便念一句哈。In sooth, I know not why I am so sad. 噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔噔 But how I caught it, found it, or came by it, what stuff is made of, whereof it is born, I am to learn. And such a wanted sadness makes of me that I have much ado to know myself. 所以大部分的当时剧本都是用这样的格律去写，但中间也有几段是散文体，没有格式，没有格律，没有押韵。到时候我们也可以去讨论看为什么会有这样的差异。所以这也是英国文艺复兴剧本会流传下来的另外一个重要的原因。它不只是内容很有意思，然后对当时文化影响很深。同时他也有他，因为就是他也算是韵文诗作，所以他也有他文学上面的造诣。这当中莎士比亚就是也是就是很厉害的创作者。如果我们去比对他早期跟晚期的作品，就会发现他对于格律的运用越来越熟了。一开始可能就像是我刚刚读到这一段，刚好就是每一句就是比如说就是一个子句或是一个完整句子，然后他就会在行尾就 刚好隔日用完了，他就会换下一句，下每一行都一句这样。但是越到后面，他越不受这样的隔日限制，他一句可以横跨好几行，甚至从中开始，然后从中结束，甚至同样的字可以断成两横，连接起来。他越不受隔日限制，他越有表现的空间。所以这也是我们可以留意。那莎士比亚另外一个特色是，像在莎士比亚之前甚至之后的剧作家，他们就很 focus 在某一种剧本，像譬如说，英国文学第二把交椅马洛 Christopher Marlowe，他的剧本都是悲剧，或是就会有人专门去写喜剧，然后你就看这种剧本，就是从头到尾都是悲剧的话，从头到尾都是喊喊喳喳，喜剧的话，从头到尾都是搞笑。也不是搞笑，这个要讲，因为我们会看喜剧。喜剧中的定义不是让笑，喜剧的定义是，到了结尾的时候，重要的人都还活着，而且彼此结婚。所以这个其实是一个判断类型的方式之一。如果到剧尾有重要人物没有结婚的话，那不是喜剧，而是另外一种类型。但是到了莎士比亚，他就另外一个创举是。他悲喜交加，悲剧很多打打杀杀，但是中间会有一点搞笑的地方，然后又继续打打杀杀。喜剧里面也是，他虽然感觉很轻飘飘的，大家彼此欢乐，但是底下会有一层比较黑暗面在那边，让整个剧本不会像是虚无缥缈，比较有分量。所以读起来呢？有人就会觉得说，感觉痛跳太大了，跟不上。但是也会有人觉得说，这样子比较像是真实人生会遇到的事情，比较有感触。看你们啦，但总之他这也是他剧本特色之一。好，所以莎剧的简介大概到这里。不要提问。好，没有的话，我先发讲义，然后我再打过来。好，我先发讲义，然后我们来简介瘟疫第三个这句戏。If you want me to switch to English, just let me know. I'm more than happy to teach it. Let's take a look at，我们看一下这个剧本。剧本一开头，第一个会给你的是，人物列表。它是用拉丁文呈现，叫做 dramatis personae。 Dramatis personae 拉丁文其实就是the people of the play， 或是 the characters of the play。然后你会发现，哎，它怎么开头有一个中括号？也许写作课有教过你，中括号意思是它这个不是原作者写，这个是事后加上去的。所以人物列表这一出戏的所有版本里面都没有一个人物列表，这个都是编辑事后加上去的。有些剧的版本确实有人物列表，所以到时候就可能会有一些变化。人物列表传统的列法是就像这样子，先把男生列上来，重要的男生，再列重要的女生。好，对对，你这不是传统，传统是先列重要的男生，再列重要的女生，然后再列一些不重要的人。但是他这边做法不太一样，当然就是因为这出戏男生很多，所以这一段全部都男生，但是这一段两个主要的女角下面有他们两个男主角，然后右边又有另外一方来的几个男性角色，然后最后真正不重要的人放在这里，这个都是跑龙套的，就是尤其演那种历史剧不需要什么军人、服务人、法官，就是有一些不重要的角色。然后最后会跟你讲说设定在哪里，然后他这个设定设在意大利，当时意大利不是个国家，意大利是1871年才成立，所以设在威尼斯跟贝尔蒙这两个叫什么城市 city state， 中文是什么，就又是城市又是国家那种独立城市嘛。总之是故事的背景是一个讲意大利文的地方。那为什么会这样子呢？他不是沙翁不是英国作家吗？对，可是他故事取材非常多元，有一些来自很多来自意大利，有一些来自西班牙，有一些来自苏格兰，然后也有一些来自中世纪英国都有。那刚好这故事是发生在威尼斯的附近。很多他的取材是来自于历史典故或是传说，非常少有独创的剧本。对，这应该也是根据，这可能是根据马洛之前有一个剧本叫做 The Jew of Malta， 因为虽然他叫做 The Merchant of Venice， 但是他其实里面一个重要的角色是这个人 Shylock， A rich Jew， 有钱的犹太人，算是有人说算是这个剧本的反派角色。好，那当然你看这边的人物跟彼此之间的关系会有点混乱。通常就是我们剧本读着读着，然后出现一个新的人，搞不懂他是谁，就可以翻回来去比对一下。所以下面剧本就直接开始了，一之一第一幕第一景。那也是上中括号，因为这个剧本的版本也没有分幕分景，大部分当时的剧本没有正式分幕分景，像刚刚讲的，就是按照演员不同角色去分，所以剧作家不用特别去这样分。但是这个是后来成型的惯例，通常都是五幕剧。那所以每一个版本的编辑都会自己决定说这五幕应该如何分配比较好。然后通常每一幕里面只要有换场景就换下一景。好，然后我们用的这个版本，你看右边有些行，右边有编号，这些编号首先它是行数，但是它不是每一行都给你行数，只有对照下面需要注释的那几行才会给你行数。那大部分的注释都是解释型的，像什么这个字什么意思，或是如果有些句子特别困难的话，他就会用这样的方式来实现，用三节号从这边开始，这边结束，这一句翻成白话文什么意思。好，我看一下 Such a want with sadness makes of me makes of me， 他翻成 Such sadness makes me so distracted lacking in good sense，就是我伤心到失去一般理智。 啊，所以大部分的注释应该可以帮助你们理解。啊，如果你哪个地方注释也不够的话，你其实可以上网查啦，他们都是经典作品，网络资源很多。但是我一直秉持一个原则，就是文学课都希望可以接触到人文，尤其莎士比亚特别重要，是因为如果你真的能够看懂并欣赏莎士比亚的作品，你就能够感受到英文的弹性。我们学英文的时候，常常会当做就是一个字对应到一个中文字，或是这一句话就可以直接翻译成中文的版本。但是莎士比亚的语言命又告诉我们说，英文里面的资源也是非常丰富的。很多单字其实是比喻性的，或是很多复合型的单字，譬如说，刚好我们看到这个 want wit，want 的意思是 lack 缺乏，wit 是机智或是那个智识，所以 want wit 缺乏智识。然后它这边是当做形容词，因为它形容的是 sadness，这样的伤心让我缺乏自制，就是下面翻成失去理智，就是非常有弹性的一个语言运用。所以有时候也会看到句子的顺序本身也很有弹性，也许会倒装，也许会先把受词放到前面，因为他自己觉得比较重要，或是要符合格律或什么的。所以我们在阅读莎句的时候，如果有哪个地方感觉不太了解在讲什么，可以想想看这些元素是不是顺序换一换，是不是可以用单字上的联想，譬如说 overpeer 这个字，它是一个动词，因为它前面有加 do 嘛，所以你知道它是一个动词。peer 当动词是观看、俯瞰的意思。所以 overpeer 其实可以联想到，它意思就是由上往下看，或者是可以放眼望去看到，类似这样子的联想概念。好，我们休息一下，回来我讲解一下威尼斯商人的故事再讲什么。好，还有时间的话，带你看一字一路。如果还没签到的话，可以来这边签到。哦，所以是，另外的那个，还是要不就是不要，没有，没有，没有，那这样子上吗？是新的吗？从创造地方的，他们就他们本身，还是不能使用的。
看到吗？这个人都在上面。我要重新记。
我们这题的话，是第七期，我们在第七期。
听说什么？
上次那个包的，他们叫哪个？哪个准备？你只要把那个事情忘记，没
什么意思。
我去，这个在中间，去了这些，来，下来上来了。 You can see. You are using power. To water this.
You have a point. No.
Oh, my little. Is it me?
Don't doubt it doesn't exist. Don't speak up. And what I should have said. To keep playing it. So who's it?
Yes.
So yes. That's simply the way. Don't forget the name. My name. Okay. Just drink it. Street art on the route. Stolen and having shower shit. I don't know. I'm not done stolen about it. Here's a bit of New York. I lost it in sugar.
I know.
You're
not. Oh, I don't. So you know what you're late.
You're getting me, James.
I'm getting a very funny. I'm very difficult. I'm very hard to go in.
It's not so.
Just, I lost it. Almost that's it. Very good. We go out.
Thank you. Oh, okay.
For having me. Yeah, no, we don't know about. Feels out.
It's not very hard to.
Some. Times before, okay. Oh, you're not a maternal.
Oh, you know.
Stop the matters. It's all in there.
Oh, yeah, that was really mad.
That's on you.
It's a young one, but it's not it.
Oh, the lady.
I'm not sorry, is it?
I'm sorry, I'm sorry.
I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. That's the one. I'm not going to be able to do it.
Then, I'm going to go to the next one. 小时候就觉得那个感觉就是，因为我们长就是生了钱，一个面膜十个来吃。那跟老师觉得，这个学生不管就是那个蛮乖的学生。
不是，不是，
跟你说蛮好，就是你希望学的是很好的事情，因为什么去让他去管家。
嗯，
对呀。
是教育的嘛？就是，
那个很熟练。那之后，现在我们主要就是能忘词，看能力，
你也可以去那个网站，可以放
哦，那我给你了。
可
以。嗯，我很放心。不然我再问专业的人怎么解，那个效果。可是我们有时候不下班，下暑假那段时间都不行。都不能给，这种，不常。不知道是比较，像谁，比如像个四个厨师，自我尝试就是，真的是舒服吗？不是，我去跳啊，这我就是背大概就是这样，看不到你。
有。
我第一次考背，
背那，给我写一个。
我后面一个是真没钱，是吧？反正都没说你话了。刚刚有一个问题的，就是看新闻去了，因为这个房子首先不是，就去老板，我们到了哪里，然后谁知道，你在学先到哪里就好，然后开始来找老师，你
这个不学的，房子不学，
他们家不学的话，你肯定听不出来，有过的很紧。然后他们说：“这个那是外国人，我们老多人知道。”哈哈，你知道外国人是老多，你出来跟你们说，老板就是我们那个那个东，然后他们
听了
笑笑，特别搞笑，
操！
不然能去？你知道那个冰柜当时你讲的，你放这边这个情况还完了吗？晚上11点多，我到了第二个酒店。老板说：“你下一趟到了台后面，我一刚才交的时候，你不知道没有？”
我们来讲一下威尼斯商人这个故事在讲。威尼斯商人是他 Antonio a merchant of Venice， 他的好朋友 Bassanio 突然爱上了 Belmont 的贵族女生叫 Portia， 在那是 Portia。所以呢，为了追求他呢，巴桑尼奥需要巨额的资产去买你送礼啊，然后又要横跨从威尼斯到拜仁什么什么，需要钱。巴桑尼奥没有钱，但是哦，安东尼奥是一个大商人，所以呢，巴桑尼奥就跟他好朋友安东尼奥借钱。安东尼奥说：“哎，刚好我大部分的钱都正在运货，就是还没有没办法兑现，但是呢，我认识很多别的商人，我可以帮你凑。”所以他就去凑。他怎么凑钱呢？跟他朋友借嘛。那其中他借钱的对象是这个人 ，Shylock， 他就写 a rich Jew， 很有钱的犹太人。那这个时候就要说明，西方世界长久以来对犹太人非常的歧视，主要原因是因为圣经里面，把耶稣赐死的人都是犹太人。其实仔细想想，耶稣本人也是犹太人啊。耶稣不是基督教是信耶稣嘛？那耶稣信谁？所以他耶稣本人也是犹太人，所以这个其实有点不合理。但总之，西方世界有这样的丑陋的传统，会觉得说都是犹太人害死耶稣。虽然说圣经里面耶稣本来就应该要死，他才能够复活，就不合理。那所以因为有这样的歧视，所以犹太人就生出一些。刻板印象，比如说 爱赚钱，这就是一个。所以当他这边说 Shara 是一个富有的犹太人，这其实是一个负面的形容。那在这出戏里面主要的冲突也就来自于他借钱的把钱借出去的条件，因为他说是这样子，好，我可以把钱借给你，但是因为 Antonio 你长久以来对我的歧视，然后对我的这个不公平待遇，所以这个钱呢，如果你没办法准时还给我，全额还给我，我就要割你一磅的肉。然后 Antonio 居然答应。好，所以他 Antonio 把钱借齐了，拿给 Bassanio， Bassanio 拿去追求 Portia。殊不知 Portia 这个时候不是随便任何人都可以追的，他父亲过世前遗嘱上面有写，要能够 成功回答一道谜语才能够娶我的女人。所以So in order,
you know.
约瑟认识的兄弟们，
So in order to marry Portia, Bassanio has to answer this riddle. Now, answering one riddle is not very exciting. So before Bassanio, we have two other people who want to marry Portia. These two. The Prince of Morocco and the Prince of Aragon. Morocco today is Morocco. Aragon is somewhere in Spain, 西班牙某处。So anyway, these two people come from far away, but they both fail the riddle. And that way we know what happens if Bassanio also fails. So the main story of this play is one, Bassanio trying to win Portia's hand in marriage, and the other one is what's going to happen if Antonio can't return the money in time. And spoiler alert, Antonio is not able to return the money in time. Shylock says, we agreed if you can't return my money in time, you have to give me 1 pound of your flesh. 身体上一磅的肉。Of course, if you cut off 1 pound from a person, the person dies. So that's a problem. And the play, the ending of the play is how to work through that problem. Now, this play is famous because of the way that Shylock is portrayed. As I said, he is a Jew, and in this play, Jewish people are presented as evil or like not entirely human. But Shakespeare makes it clear that when the other characters are discriminating against Shylock, they're not using the same standard that we would use today. They discriminate against him, first of all, based on religion. You'll notice when we read through the play that the thing that the other characters most use against Shylock is that he's not willing to be merciful. The idea is that if Jesus could die to save everyone else, then surely you can forgive Antonio his debt. 就如果耶稣都能够牺牲自己的话，那人家欠你的钱稍微赦免一下又是怎么样？But because Shylock is not a Christian, he doesn't believe in Jesus as God. He doesn't believe in that whole thing. So he has no reason to be merciful. He has no reason to forgive Antonio's debts. And so the ending of the play is how they deal with this problem. Now, as I said, Shylock is presented as not Christian. And he's also presented as strictly following the agreement. We agree what happens if you don't pay me back. So if you don't pay me back, we have to follow the agreement, even though the agreement is a terrible agreement. So these are the two main negative traits of Shylock. But at the same time, Shakespeare makes sure that we understand how Shylock feels. In the middle, there's a speech about how being a Jewish person in a Christian society is so difficult. Everybody is discriminating against him. They kick him, they laugh at him, they try to cheat him. And how that experience is why he is so unwilling to forgive Antonio's debt. If they treat me so poorly, why should I treat them well? Now, remember that this play was first performed in a Christian society. When this play was performed, most people in England did think that it was okay to treat Jewish people poorly, to discriminate against Jewish people. In fact, for a long time in English history, Jewish people were not allowed to enter England. So in terms of the politics of the play, Shakespeare was truly doing something new and some would say dangerous. If we truly follow Shakespeare's characterization of Shylock, then we have to agree that the way most people, most English people treated Jewish people is wrong. So in a sense, Shakespeare is saying to his audience, if you do this, you are wrong. And that really gives this play its power. It's not just entertainment, it's also trying to, well, not trying, but it also does shock the contemporary audience. So those are the two main parts of the story, but you also have something happening in Shylock's own family, right? We have Jessica, his daughter. And the idea of this part of the story is that Shylock is such a terrible person that his daughter wants to run away and become a Christian. And we can also think about whether that is fair to Shylock. On the one hand, Christians at the time discriminated against Jewish people. So by becoming Christian, Jessica can escape this discrimination. On the other hand, she is abandoning her father. And not just her father, but her father's traditions. So that's also something we can think about as we read the play. So that's the main story. There is a movie, but it's too long to show in class, and I'm not sure that there are Chinese subtitles. But if you are really interested, you can try to find the movie. I haven't seen it before. Okay, so that's the main story. Questions? Okay, we have a little time left, so let's begin reading, and I'll take you through the beginning of the play. Okay, Act 1, Scene 1. Enter Antonio, Salerio, and Solanio. Okay, of these three people, only Antonio is important. The other two are like Shalodo. Antonio. In sooth, I know not why I am so sad. In sooth, it says down here, it means truly. Sooth means truth. So, in truth, which is emphasis, 加强语气. I know not why I am so sad. It wearies me. I'm tired because I'm so sad. And you say it wearies you. So you say, when you keep hearing me say, oh, I'm so sad, you also feel tired of this. But how I caught it, found it, or came by it, what stuff is made of, what stuff it is made of, why I am so sad, whereof it is born, whereof means from where. I am to learn, which means I don't know. Right? If you have to learn something, that means you don't know it. So he's sad, but he doesn't know why. And such a want with sadness makes of me that I have much ado to know myself. And this sadness, as it says here, sorry. How do I get knowledge? Okay, so this sadness, makes me so distracted, lacking a good sense, that I don't even know myself. I have much ado means I have a lot left to do to know myself. In order to know myself, I have to do a lot, which means I really don't know myself. So in China, you would say, 拿上心到忘我, right? He's so sad, he has no idea why. He doesn't even know like who he is anymore. Celerio, your mind is tossing on the ocean, there where your argosies was courtly stale. And it says here, argosies are large merchant ships, sangchuan. So this gives us new information. Antonio is a merchant, and he has many merchant ships sailing around the world, making money for him. Argosies with portly sail, this is a chuan. So like the canvas on top of the ship. Like signors and rich burghers on the flood. These are two Italian words, just means rich and important people. On the flood here means the ocean. So your ships are like important and rich people. Or as it were, the pageants of the sea. And below it tells us that pageant is a kind of stage used in performance. So your ships are so full of riches that they're like rich and important people, or they're like part of a performance. It's so unreal how much money is on these ships. And your ships do overpeer the petty traffickers that curtsy to them. So your ships are so big that they look over all of the smaller ships, and the smaller ships seem to pay obedience to your bigger ships, to do them reverence, 对人敬重, right, to give them respect, as they fly by them with their woven wings. So like this stanza is a very poetic way of saying, you're sad because you're thinking about all of your big and rich ships on the sea, and you don't know if they will come home safely. Solanio, believe me, sir, had I such venture forth, had I means if I had. This kind of sentence we still use in English today, if I had. Venture here just means like an effort. So if I had this thing going on, the better part of my affections, which means most of my emotions and attention, the better part of my affections would change. The better part of my affection would be with my hopes abroad. So most of my attention and emotions would also be with my ships out on the sea. I should be still plucking the grass to know where sits the wind. So I would be so worried, I would be plucking the grass to know how the wind blows, peering in maps for ports and piers and roads. I would be looking at the maps to see where my ships would go, where they would end up, how I could get there faster. And every object that might make me fear misfortune to my ventures, out of doubt would make me sad. So object, so everything that might make me afraid that what if these ships don't come home safely? What if I lose all of my money? Everything that makes me think this, I would be afraid of. And no doubt, out of doubt means no doubt, all of this would make me sad. So his two friends are trying to comfort Antonio, right? He's saying, I'm so sad, I don't know why. And his friends are saying, you're sad because you're worried about your ships and your money. By the way, the word should here, it does not mean something that you should do. Should in older English just means would for the first person, the and send the would, right? So I should just means I would. And then Solerio continues. I should tell you, you'll notice that this line begins in the middle, right? And this is because, in terms of the poetry, these two lines are the same line. This is one line. So, like on the right, you have line numbers, right? If you count the line numbers, these two halves are one line. Because of the format of the poetry. So Solerio continues, my wind cooling my broth would blow me to an ague when I thought what harm a wind too great might do at sea. So broth means soup. So if a wind came to blow my soup cold, it would give me a cold. Ague is like an illness. It would make me sick. Because I would think about what if this wind is blowing at my ships? What danger would it cause? I should not see the sandy hourglass run, but I should think of shallows and of flats. I would not look at time passing or the hourglass. So if I see an hourglass run, right? So I see the sand running through the hourglass, it would make me think of shallows, so like places where the sea is not deep, and the flats, same thing. And see my wealthy Andrew, you'll notice this is in italics, JTC. It's the name of a ship. And so thinking about this sand and these beaches would make me see my wealthy ship docked in sand. Good ship. So stuck on sand. Bathing her high top lower than her ribs to kiss her bearing. So if a high top is lower than the body of the ship, that means the ship has turned over. And so to kiss her burial, like the ship has died. So even looking at an hourglass would make me afraid of for my ships. Should I go to church? So if I go to church and see the holy edifice of stone, which is the church building, right, made of stone, and not bethink me straight of dangerous rocks. The stone of the church would make me think immediately, straight means straight away, immediately, of dangerous rocks, which touching but my gentle vessel's side, vessel means ship, would scatter all her spices on the stream. So one thing that merchants would buy and sell at that time was spices, 酱料. So here he's talking about the money and the important goods on Antonio's ship. So even if he looks at a stone church, he would think of dangerous rocks that might cut into his ships and scatter all of the merchandise, right? Scatter all his spices on the stream. Stream means water. Enrobe the roaring waters with my silks, 丝绸. So like all this, expensive silk would also be flowing on the water. And in a word, but even now worth this, and now worth nothing. So even now means now. In Chinese, we say 一下降, right? So now worth so much, and the next moment worth nothing, because it's all lost on the sea. Shall I have the thought to think on this? And shall I lack the thought that such a thing be chanced would make me sad? So if I think of these things, could it be possible that I would not feel sad because of them? But tell not me. You don't have to tell me. I know Antonio is sad to think upon his merchandise. So why is Antonio sad? His friends think it's because of the danger posed to his ships in trade. But Antonio says, believe me, no. I thank my fortune for it. My ventures are not in one bottle trusted. So I thank my fortune means thankfully. My ventures are not in one bottom trusted. Bottom means ship, right? Like one bottom of the ship. Because the bottom of the ship is where you put your merchandise. So he's saying that my stuff on the sea is not all in one ship, nor to one place. So he's selling things at the same time to many different places. Nor is my whole estate, estate means fortune, all of his money. Nor is my whole estate upon the fortune of this present year. So not all of my money has to come in this year. I'm trading over many years. Therefore, my merchandise makes me not sad. The idea is if he loses one ship, he has many other ships. If he loses all of his ships, he has more things going on next year. So this is not why he's sad. Okay, so his friends continue seeking another possible reason. Solanio, why then you are in love? Okay, so the word why is not a question. Why is just a sound. That's 语助词, it doesn't mean anything. But why then you are in love? Antonio, fi means go to. In Chinese, you would say 滚啊, right? Don't say such things. Solanio, not in love either? Then let us say you are sad because you are not married. Married means happy. So he's saying, you're sad because you're not happy. And tour means it were. Tour as easy for you to laugh at me. They say you are married because you are not sad. So if there really is no reason, then the only reason you're sad is because you're not happy. So if you want to be happy, all you have to do is think that you're not sad. Okay, sure, why not? Okay, grammar. It were as easy, which means it would be as easy. Right, so it's a comparison, right? He's comparing Antonio now is sad because he's not happy with In the future, maybe Antonio can become happy because he's not sad. These two things are equally easy. So all you have to do is become happy. Great. Thanks for the advice. Now, by two-headed Janus, or I should say Janus. So this is an oath. 有点像是在发誓, right? It's another expletive, 语助词. But in English today, actually also in Chinese, right? If you think of curse words, 脏话, most curse words are some kind of swearing, some kind of oath on something important. So, for example, in English, we might say, God damn. Literally, that means God damns someone or something, right? There's an important aspect of God in that curse. Or in Chinese, we might say, like, 靠腰, which means literally that your parents have died, right? So when we curse, there's always something important in the meaning of those words. So in fact, when he says, by two-headed Janus, Janus is an ancient Roman god. So this is a curse. It's a very light curse. It doesn't really mean too much. It's just like giving this energy. And why is Janus two-headed? Janus is the god of endings and beginnings. So traditionally, the figure of Janus is one is looking two ways, this way and that way. So it's two-headed. In fact, this might look familiar to you. The name for the first month of the year, January, comes from Janus. It's the month that ends the previous year and begins the next year. So, curse, okay. Nature has framed strange fellows in her time. Nature has created strange people throughout history. Some that will evermore peek through their eyes and laugh like parrots at a bagpiper. In other words, someone who will laugh at anything. Even someone playing the bagpipe. The bagpipe is a musical instrument popular in Scotland. I can't remember the Chinese name. 苏格兰笛吗? 你知道我在讲什么吗? 那个苏格兰的那个传统乐器, 那个跟我叫, 什么羊皮笛啊, bagpipes. Anyway, if you want to know the Chinese, you can look it up online. So some people are always happy, always laughing, and other people of such vinegar aspect. Vinegar is sour, right? Has a 醋, vinegar, 醋. So he's talking about how some people are always so upset and sour at other people that they'll not show their teeth in way of smile, though Nestor swear the jest be laughable. So no matter what, they will never smile, never laugh. Even if Nestor says that it's a funny joke. Who's Nestor? So if you remember in the second half of your freshman year, you guys read or talked about the Odyssey, right? Odyssey. Nestor is one of the characters in the Odyssey. He is an old man who, and also in the Iliad, he's an old man full of wisdom, and he's always very serious. So if a joke can make Nestor laugh, then it must be really funny. But here, Solanio is saying some people will laugh at anything, some other people will laugh at nothing. And so he's also still trying to comfort Antonio, right? If you want, you can simply become the other kind of person and suddenly you're not sad anymore. Okay, so the first kind of dialogue establishes that Antonio is sad for some strange reason. Nobody knows why. Enter Bassanio, Lorenzo, and Graziano. Again, Lorenzo and Graziano, not very important people. Bassanio is the important person here. And what do they say? Sorry, this is still Salanio. Here comes Bassanio, your most noble kinsman. Kinsman means family member. So here comes your family member, Bassanio, Brantanio, and Lorenzo, right? So he introduces who Bassanio is, but he doesn't introduce these two people because they're not very important. Fare ye well. Fare ye well means farewell. Farewell means goodbye. So Salanio is leaving. We leave you now with better company. Company means group of people. So like Bassanio is family, we are not family. So now that this more important person has come, we are going to go. Salerio. I would have stayed till I had made you merry if worthier friends had not prevented me. So I would have stayed, but Salanio wants me to go. Obviously, these two people are tired of dealing with a depressed Antonio. They don't actually want to stay, but they're saying this to be polite. Right? There's no reason they have to leave just because Bassanio arrives. It's an excuse. They just don't want to stay. And so by leaving, Salerio compliments Bassanio, saying that he is a worthier friend. He's a more valuable friend. Antonio, your worth is very dear in my regard. I also think you are a valuable friend. I take it your own business calls on you. So from what I understand, that you have to deal with your own business. This phrase, I take it that something something, just means I understand that something something. This, we still say this in modern English. And you embrace the occasion to depart. And because you have business, you are using this situation to leave me. Embrace means to hug or to welcome. So this is happening, you welcome this situation so you can leave. This is simply the, but the E has been left out to fit the meter, right? And you embrace the occasion to depart. There's no room for the E. Good morrow, Salerio. Good morrow, my good lords. Which means see you tomorrow. Right? Morrow. See you tomorrow. And then they leave soon after. Bassanio. Good signors both. Signor just means sir. So he's talking to Salanio and Salerio. When shall we laugh? Say when. So I guess laugh here means like go to a bar and have fun. You grow exceeding strange. Strange here means unfamiliar. So like there's a distance. So like it's been a long time since we went out together. What's going on? We are growing further apart. You grow exceeding strange. Must it be so? Does it have to be like this? So just means like this, in this way. Must it be like this? So there we are. We'll make our leisures to attend on yours. Which means next time you want to hang out, just call for us. Make our leisure means to, leisure means recreation, entertainment, fun. So to make one's leisure means to make time for. To attend on means to follow. So we will make time if you want us to go and have fun with you. This doesn't really, it's not very important. They're just, it's sort of like they're saying hello and goodbye. Right, when somebody appears in your group, you have to say something to them to be polite. So that's what they're doing. Exeunt Salerio and Salanio. Exeunt means exit more than one person. Exit means leave. So here it's saying these two people leave the stage. Lorenzo, my lord Bassanio, since you have found Antonio, we two will leave you. Ah, so the other two people, Lorenzo and Graziano, simply accompany Bassanio to find Antonio. And now that they have found Antonio, these two people are also going to leave. We two will leave you, but at dinner time, I pray you means please. So at dinner time, please have in mind where we must meet. So we're going to go now, but remember to meet up for dinner. And Bassanio says, I will not fail you, so no problem. Graziano, you look not well, Signor Antonio. Yes, because Antonio is very sad. You have too much respect upon the world, which means you are too respected, you are too important, and therefore you have to worry about too many things. They lose it that do buy it with much care. So care here means worry. So if you have to worry so much when you are the important person, then it's not worth it. If you have to buy something with so much worry, it's the same as not buying. That's what this means. Believe me, you are marvelously changed. Marvelously is not a positive word. Today we say marvelous, great, right? Good things. But at the time, marvelous just means in a kind of like a magical, unexpected way. But it's not positive. It just means big. It might even be negative. Magic is not a good thing in traditional culture. So believe me, you are marvelously changed. You are very different from the last time we met. So Graziano gives a third reason why Antonio is so sad, because he's worried about too many things. And so Antonio's response, I hold the world, but as the world, which means I only worry about the world as much as I have to. I don't worry too much. A stage where every man must play a part. And mine a sad one. So he's saying the world is like a stage. Everyone has a character they have to play, and my character is a sad character. So why is he sad? Antonio is saying, I don't worry too much, I'm just sad. Graziano, let me play the fool. The fool is like the clown, 丑角. Let me play the fool with mirth and laughter. So laughing and happiness. Let old wrinkles come. So Graziano is saying, if Antonio has to be a sad character, I am going to be a happy character. And I'm going to laugh until wrinkles grow on my face. 出现笑纹. And let my liver rather heat with wine than my heart cool with mortifying groans. So another comparison, I would rather drink until my liver gets up, becomes hot, rather than groan, which means complain, until my heart grows cold. Why should a man whose blood is warm within sit like his grandsire cut in alabaster? So why should a living person, a man whose blood is warm, a living person, why should a living person sit like a statue? Alabaster is the kind of stone used to create a statue. Grandsire just means grandfather. So why should someone who is alive sit like a statue? Sleep when he wakes and creep into the jaundice by being peevish. This is the same question. Why should a person sleep when he is awake, when he wakes up? Why should he grow jaundice, which is a disease that can create yellow skin, by being peevish, by caring too much, by splitting hairs? Why should a person live like this? I tell thee what, Antonio, thee just means you. I tell you what, Antonio, I love thee as a friend, of course. I love thee, and 'tis my love that speaks. So I'm telling you this because I'm your friend. And you're Graciano, right? I'm your friend. There are a sort of men whose visages, which means face, do cream and mantle like a standing pond. So a standing pond is a body of water that is stagnant, that doesn't move. 静止的水. So like if you have a body of water that doesn't flow, things grow in the water. And he's saying some people's faces are like that. And do a willful stillness entertain with purpose to be dressed in an opinion of wisdom, gravity, profound conceit. So some people like to keep their face very still, so that like a body of water with no movement where things grow, on their faces can grow the idea of wisdom, seriousness, that other people will think that he is an important person. Right? Opinion here means other people's opinions. Entertain means to invoke or to welcome, to incite, elicit, 引起. So like some people like to keep their face very still, so other people will think they are wise. Gravity means serious. Profound means deep. So some people think you're wise, you're serious, you're deep. Just like someone who would say, as who should say, I am Sir Oracle. Oracle is someone who knows the future. I am Sir Oracle. And when I open my lips, let no dog bark. Oak means open. So I'm such a serious person. When I start talking, not only should you not interrupt me, not even a dog is allowed to interrupt me. Oh, my Antonio, I do know of these people, that therefore only are reputed wise for saying nothing. Repute is the verb for reputation. Means that they are reputed wise, means people think that they are wise. For means because, just because they say nothing. When I'm very sure, if they should speak, would almost damn those ears which hearing them to call their brothers fools. In other words, if they do start talking, the people who thought they were wise would curse each other for thinking that this foolish person is a wise person. I'll tell thee more of this another time. But fish not with this melancholy bait for this full gudgeon, this opinion. So don't be like those people. Don't use your melancholy, your sadness, to fish for the good opinions of other people. Come, good Lorenzo. Fare ye well a while, which means goodbye for now. I'll end my exhortation after dinner. So after dinner, I'll come back and tell you the rest of my thinking. Exhortation here means kind of advice or encouragement. And then he says to Antonio and Bassanio, well, we will leave you then till dinner time. I must be one of these same dumb wise men, for Graciano never lets me speak. Sorry, this is Lorenzo. So Graciano says, we're going to have dinner and then we'll come back and keep talking. Lorenzo says, yes, we're going to have dinner. And he's saying, if not speaking makes people think you're wise, I must be one of those people because Graciano never lets me talk. So people must think that I'm wise. And then they say a bit more, and then they say a bit more, and then they leave here. Exit Graziano and Lorenzo. And then the rest of the scene is between Antonio and Bassanio. And that's when Bassanio tells Antonio that he needs money to pursue Portia. Okay, so before next week, please read up to the end of Act 2, Scene 5. 第五部第五，呃，第二部第五。 So finish Act 2, Scene 5. See. Do 1, 2, 5. Up to here. So read up to here. This is on page 196. So that's how many pages? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 pages. 9, around 10 pages. Okay, if you have not yet signed in, please come sign in. Otherwise, I will see you next week.
I'm going to go to the next slide.